Hello everyone, this video is about triphenyl methane. If you have studied microbiology anytime, you can quickly make out. This substance has to do something with bacterial staining. There is also interesting story about a Moses Gomber, who is considered as founder of organic free radicals. So we are going to see that story also. Let's get started. If you have not yet seen a video of diphenyl methane, please watch it first. Then it will be easy for you to understand triphenyl methane. As the name is saying, it is tri, so three, phenyl, so three benzene rings, which are present as a substituent on central methane. So this central methane, out of the four hydrogens, three are replaced with the benzene rings. And last hydrogen is there with the central carbon. IUPAC name, because we are numbering all the benzene rings from 1 to 6. First number is given to the carbon which is bearing this central carbon. So this will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Similarly, this will be 1 dash, 2 dash, 3 dash, up to 6 dash. Third ring, 1 double dash, 2 double dash, 3 double dash, up to 6 double dash. So it is 1 dash, 1 double dash, methane, tryl, tribenzene. This is the IUPAC name. This substance is also called as tritane. And if this is present as a substituent, then tritile or even carbocation or free radical, they are also called as tritile radical or ion. Molecular formula, 3 benzene rings, so 6 threes are 18 plus this central, so C19. Each again carrying 5 hydrogens because 1 is substituted, so 15 plus this 16. So it is C19, H16. As compared to diphenyl methane, this is quite stable. So it is solid, which will melt at 93. We have seen diphenyl methane was melting at ambient room temperature. So this will exist in the form of solid and it will melt at 93 degrees Celsius. Because of non-polar 3 rings and all carbons and hydrogens, it is highly organic in nature. So it is soluble in organic solvents and it is insoluble in water. Now, coming to the synthetic methods, the very first method of synthesizing triphenyl methane that was reported by Auguste Kekulé. Now, we know him very well for discovery of benzene. He, along with his student, Franchimont, they carried out this synthesis in 1872. What they did, they reacted diphenyl mercury, that is two benzene rings and mercury element in between, with benzyl chloride. Now, in all the synthetic methods, you need to always look at, are there sources for three benzene rings? So here first reactant is providing two benzene rings. Another reactant is providing one benzene ring. So there should be sources for three benzene rings and one source for the carbon. So here benzyl chloride is providing central carbon. So when these two react in presence of hydrochloric acid, there will be loss of HgCl2, because this is divalent metal. HgCl2 will get removed from this reaction to give triphenyl methane. Most popular method for synthesis of triphenyl methane is Friedel-Crafts reaction. So either we can take the simplest case, that is three benzene rings and a source of carbon as a chloroform. When they react in presence of Lewis acid, aluminum trichloride, we get a substitution product, triphenyl methane. Every time when this carbon will be substituted on this ring, there will be elimination of one HCl molecule. So 3 benzene with chloroform, they give us triphenyl methane along with elimination of 3 hydrochloride molecules. If we look at step by step how this reaction happens, first benzene molecule will react with chloroform to give benzyl chloride with loss of 1 HCl. Now this benzyl chloride will react with second molecule of benzene to give diphenyl methane chloride. Now this will react with third molecule of benzene to give us triphenyl methane. So as I said, every time you need to look at sources for 3 benzene rings and 1 carbon. So there is also a possibility that 2 molecules of benzene react with benzaldehyde. So benzaldehyde is already carrying 1 carbon in the form of oxygen. So benzaldehyde plus 2 molecules of benzene can also give us triphenyl methane, this time with loss of water, because 2 hydrogens from these 2 benzene rings, when substitution will occur, 2 hydrogens from these 2 benzene rings and this 1 oxygen, they will eliminate in the form of water. Similar to Friedel-Crafts reaction, there is also possibility of reacting 3 benzene rings with carbon tetrachloride, but because there are 4 chlorine, 3 hydrochloric acid molecules will be removed and last chlorine will be still attached. So we will get triphenyl chloromethane, which upon acidic hydrolysis with HCl, that chloride will get removed in the form of Cl2, and we will get our desired product, triphenyl methane. Triphenyl methane can also be obtained from triphenyl carbinol. Carbinol contains hydroxy group to the central carbon atom. So this needs to be reduced or dehydroxylated. Removal of this OH and addition of H will give us the product. This is only possible with one special reducing agent, as reported by one of the research paper. This reagent is sodium cyanotrihydroborate. So actually this will be a salt form. If you attach sodium over here, it will be sodium cyanotrihydroborate. So upon dissociation, it will form Na plus and this BH3 CN minus. So it has been observed that when triphenyl carbinol is treated with this reagent, dehydroxylation is possible in the form of water, and we will get desired product, that is triphenyl methane. There are some other methods which are less commonly used, like reduction of triphenyl chloromethane with alcohol and in presence of strong acid like sulfuric acid. We have just now seen structure of triphenyl carbinol. So it can be heated with formic acid to give the product, or 2 molecules of benzene reacting with benzyl chloride. Benzyl chloride is this benzene ring with CHCl2. So these two can react in presence of beryllium chloride to give us triphenyl methane. Now we will discuss reactions of triphenyl methane. There is one prominent electrophilic substitution reaction which happens at the benzene rings. So when we react triphenyl methane with nitrating agents like concentrated H2SO4 and nitric acid, it gives us para substituted product. So all the benzene rings will get nitro group at their para position. So this is one reaction which is happening at rings, but there are several reactions which happen at central carbon. So let's discuss about them. When we try to form a dimer by reacting 2 molecules of triphenyl chloromethane, we usually expect such a dimer wherein all the benzene rings, they are attached in a circular fashion, so we get a symmetric molecule. But this doesn't happen. So here I want to introduce you all with a prominent scientist, Moses Gomberg. He is known as a father or a founder of organic radical chemistry. Dimer formation happens in a way he proposed it, rather than reaction between two central carbon atoms, there is reaction with one of the terminus of any one of the benzene ring. So we have four rings close to each other and rest two rings are away from this center. This is known as Gomberg's dimer. He worked a lot on radicals generated out of triphenyl methane, that is tritile radical. Moses Gomberg, born in Russia but more famous for his work in US in University of Michigan. Even he was president of American Chemical Society for a few years. He is considered as the father of free radical organic chemistry. Somewhere at the start of 1900, when he was trying to synthesize hexaphenyl ethane, the structure we saw just now, consisting of six benzene rings and two carbons at the center. So such a sterically congested structure he wanted to synthesize. So during those experiments, what he found was this tritile free radical, a mysterious, highly reactive and unstable substance, and then it gave opening to the free radicals in organics, and it helped prove that carbon is not always tetravalent. Story started much before. As we have seen, triphenyl methane, that compound exists. So several group of scientists were trying to synthesize tetraphenyl methane. Bayer, then Auguste Kekulé, all these brilliant scientists, they were working hard to synthesize a compound containing four phenyl rings as a substituent on carbon. So a central carbon attached to all four phenyl rings, no hydrogen at all. But they could not. Even another group of chemists headed by Victor Mayer, they also tried to synthesize tetraphenyl methane, but they could not, and they declared that this compound is inherently unstable, so it just cannot get synthesized. At University of Heidelberg, which is in Germany, Gomberg worked with Mayer and they used some different approach based upon the Thiele's work, and there Gomberg succeeded in synthesizing small amount of tetraphenyl methane. When he returned to US at his University of Michigan, he again optimized the method to increase the yield. So after synthesizing such a sterically congested compound consists of four phenyl rings, his next target was to synthesize fully phenylated hydrocarbon, that is hexaphenyl ethane. Six phenyl rings and central two carbon atoms. So he was trying to react two triphenyl methyl halides. Initially he used sodium because we have seen the central is acidic, you can react it with base, but this reaction was also failed. So instead of sodium, he decided to use silver. So after reacting it with silver, he got a white crystalline powder which was very much susceptible for reacting with oxygen. So it was getting oxidized very fast. So to avoid oxidation, he reacted them, that is triphenyl methyl chloride, two molecules, and zinc in atmosphere of carbon dioxide. He allowed to react them for several weeks and in a special airtight apparatus, so there is no entry of oxygen. Then he got a thick dark yellow syrup liquid. he removed benzene which was used as a solvent, and he got then the actual product which he expected to be containing 6 benzene rings and a symmetrical one. He got a white solid, but that compound was having unexpectedly very high reactivity. The moment it came in contact with, say, air or halogens, any other solvent or reagent, it immediately reacted. It was not expected from hexaphenyl ethane because that is completely rigid symmetrical structure which will not undergo any kind of reaction at such ease. So this was sufficient for Gomberg. These are his original words. The experimental evidence forces me to the conclusion that we have here a free radical, triphenyl methyl. Now it is known as trityl, abbreviation of triphenyl methyl. On this assumption alone, do the result described above become intelligible and receive an adequate explanation. The radical which is formed is apparently stable. Now it is stable because 3 benzene rings surrounding it, so they can dissipate this odd electron via resonance. So it is stable as compared to other free radicals. But usually free radicals are highly unstable and they get reacted. But this, because of resonance, it was stable unless you bring it in contact with say air or light or any other reagent. So this is so unstable when it is brought in contact with the reactions. Otherwise, if you store it nicely, it is stable. So it can be kept in the solution as well as in the dry state for several weeks. And this started a new era of free radicals. And now we can answer many types of reactions based upon free radical chain reactions. So this is how triphenyl methane was involved in the discovery of organic free radicals by Moses Gomberg. So now we can answer halogenation, that is bromination or chlorination, happens at the center instead of happening at the ring because there is radical formation. So if we are using Cl2, then there will be loss of HCl and chloride will get attached to the central carbon atom. So we will get triphenyl chloromethane. This free radical mechanism will work in this way. Initially Cl2, there will be homolytic fission to form 2 free radicals. And one of them will go along with hydrogen. So with loss of HCl, we will get trityl free radical. This trityl free radical will react with the remaining chloride radical to give us the product. Oxidation also takes place at the center. So when we react triphenyl methane with a good oxidizing agent like chromium trioxide, we get triphenyl carbinol. So there is addition of the oxygen at the center. This molecule can further react to give carbocation. This carbinol, when it is placed in acidic medium, there will be protonation of this hydroxyl group to eliminate water, and what we get is trityl carbocation. Now because this carbocation is surrounded by 3 benzene rings, there will be immediate delocalization and resonance stabilization. So because this is also reaction intermediate, it won't be that stable. But if you compare stability amongst carbocations, it is one of the most stable, because there are several resonating structures possible because of each ring that imparts stability as compared to other carbocations. Otherwise, if you look at this triphenyl methane, this central tertiary hydrogen is actually acidic. Though it is weakly acidic, pKa is very high, 33. But because it is acidic, it will react with bases. So when we react triphenyl methane with base like sodium in liquid ammonia, what we get is carbanion, and it can quickly form salt, that is a sodium salt. So such reaction indicates acidic behavior of triphenyl methane. Coming to the applications, there are actually no medicinal applications because 3-benzene rings and they are highly carcinogenic in nature. So previously it was used, but now medicinal applications, they are completely banned. So because of the rich chromophore, that is 3-benzene rings and extensive electronic conjugation, triphenyl methane is actually useful in synthesis of intensely colored dyes, which can be used as an indicators in the reactions, or say producing dyes for the fabrics, silk, wool, then even hair dyes. Coming to the pharmaceutical uses, we have pH indicators or even fluorescent reagents. So because of its ability to absorb light, emit light, this finds application in the detection purposes. Most prominent example, phenolphthalein, crystal violet, malachite green, bromocrysol green, fuchsin, Victoria blue pea. So these all are indicators widely used. Previously, for over a century, phenolphthalein was used as an laxative, and even crystal violet, malachite green, they were used to treat fungal infections and parasitosis in the fishes or other marine organisms. So they were used as a biocide, but after several use for several decades, now they are banned because they are genotoxic as well as carcinogenic. So pharmaceutical applications are largely based upon indicators. Phenolphthalein, most popular one, and every pharmacy student must have used it for determining endpoint of acid-base titrations. It consists of 3 phenyl rings and a central carbon. Additionally, there are 2 hydroxy groups and 1 carboxylate. So because it is acid, in the acidic condition, it will be unionized. It is colorless. But in the neutral and alkaline conditions, it dissociates, the acidic group dissociates, and there is resonance in either both of the rings. So it is highly colored because of electron delocalization. So it appears pink color, and we can easily monitor endpoint of acid-base reaction. Now we will see how phenolphthalein shows a color change. This animation is available at Wikipedia, so you can even watch it there also. In this animation, they have shown very nicely how color change occurs. So phenolphthalein, as we have seen, in the acidic condition, it will be colorless. So this is the form of phenolphthalein. In the unionized form, it will be colorless. The moment alkali approaches, in the alkaline condition, obviously there will be abstraction of proton. So oxygen will get a negative charge, and then slowly resonance will shift inside, leading to also ionization of this central group. Reaction can also take place at another hydrogen. And this is how it will change the color for pink. Another indicator which is widely used in microbiology for endospore staining is malachite green. So malachite green is nothing but triphenyl methane along with 2 substitutions. There is dimethyl amino. So this same substitution exists on paraposition of 2 benzene rings. So such malachite green, it is yellow in color at extremely low pH, below 0.2. Whereas pH above 1.8, it is green in color. So this is widely used in case of endospore staining. Now what are endospores? Spores are nothing but dormant stage of some bacteria. So there are several specific classes of bacteria which are capable of forming spores. Not every bacteria can do it. So there are like Bacillus species which most commonly form spores. Such bacteria, when they are exposed to adverse conditions for their living, what they do is they convert themselves into dormant stage called as spores. It is like a seed, very hard, they turn very hard so that adverse conditions do not affect them. And when normal conditions are reverted, they will come back into the vegetative form. So when this spore is inside, it is called as endospore. So if you want to distinguish whether given species, whether they are sporulating or not, endospore staining can be used. So spore is inside, denoted by this circle. Initially, bacterial culture, it is taken on the slide and it is heat fixed. So primarily, it is stained with malachite green. And after that, upon staining, it is slide is again heated to allow malachite green to penetrate inside. If there is spore, malachite green will penetrate inside. Now, a wall of this spore is very hard. So slide is then later washed. So if it is a non-sporulating organism, then simply washing will remove malachite green. But if it is a bacteria with endospore, then malachite green has penetrated inside. So upon washing, just outer green color will be washed and inside there will be central green color. Now it can be again counter stained with safranin, which gives pink or in high concentration red color. So again, when it is counter stained with safranin, vegetative cell will appear pink or red, but the cell with endospore, it will have a pink or red along with green color. So here you can see this is a sporulating organism because you can see rod shaped and there is a red coloration. Along with this, there is also green coloration. So upon microscopical examination, if you just see pink and red organism, it is a non-sporulating. But along with pink and red, if you also see green colors, then it is a sporulating organism that is having endospore. Another important indicator is crystal violet. If you compare the structure with malachite green, in malachite green there were dimethyl amino substitutions on two benzene rings. In crystal violet, such substitution is there on all the three rings. So just addition of one dimethyl amino group will convert malachite green into crystal violet. At extremely low pH, that is below minus 1, it is yellow in color, but above pH 2, it is purple or violet in color. It is most widely used in microbiology for gram staining. It will stain gram positive bacteria purple in color. So gram staining is usually the first step which is used for identification of bacteria. So this is important stain. Even crystal violet is used as an indicator in detection of titrations, say precipitation titrations. This nucleus is reported to have antibacterial, antifungal, anthelmintic, anti-trypanosomal, that is for slip disorders, anti-angiogenic, anti-tumor, but because of the carcinogenic nature, this is not explored. So this moiety is not for therapeutic use, but it is widely used for synthesis of dyes and indicators. So these are some references, and you can always refer to the basic organic chemistry books by say Bahl and Bahal, then Morrison and Boyd. There are some additional references like towards understanding of chromatic behavior of triphenyl methane derivatives, paper published in Chemical Physics, or detection of triphenyl methane drugs in fish muscle, because earlier it was used as a biocide. So to determine its traces, then you can read about landmark of free radicals, all the history of Moses Gomberg. It is available on the ACS page, that is American Chemical Society. So with this, we have completed polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. Next, we are going to take a series of lectures on cycloalkenes. So take care. Goodbye.